We dive into our full game preview of the Ravens Week 10 Thursday night football matchup with the Miami Dolphins next year on Locked On Ravens.
You are Locked On Ravens, your daily Baltimore Ravens podcast, part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day.
And we return here with another episode of Locked On Ravens. I am your host, Kevin Ostreicher of Ravens Wire. This episode of Locked On Ravens is brought to you by McDonald's, proudly serving communities since 1965. McDonald's has always been more than just a place to get tasty, affordable food. It's an unofficial community center. A big thank you to our friends at McDonald's for always being there. I'm loving it. And we return here. It is game day here on Locked On Ravens as the Ravens are in Miami to face those Miami Dolphins on Thursday night football. Baltimore at 6-2. Miami at 2-7. So two very different teams in terms of just where they are in the season right now. This should be a game that Baltimore can win. We're going to talk about why in the second and third segments. And also a bit in the first segment. And the first segment was having to the final injury report. It kind of feels weird saying that on a Thursday. Usually we're doing crossover Thursday, but because of the game, that's what it is. We're doing the full game preview here today. So in the first segment, we will be doing the injury report analysis, as well as talking about some things that players and coaches said throughout the week. And the second segment, we'll start that game preview, talk about the Ravens offense going up against the Miami defense. And then in the final segment, we'll dive into the Ravens defense going up against the Miami offense. So with all that being said, we're going to dive into it here. Before we do that, though, if you're following along with us in audio form, be sure to follow the show, turn notifications on so you know when our content comes out. On YouTube, same thing, like the video, subscribe to the channel if you're following along with us on YouTube. And as I'm actually recording this right now, I noticed that it looks like I am in Miami on YouTube. I have the beach background. I'm wearing a teal shirt. So yeah, it's looking like I picked out the wrong shirt for this one, but it's okay. If you want to see what I'm wearing, head on over to YouTube. But follow us, subscribe to the channel, like the video, follow me on Twitter at ChaosTracker34 and the Locked On Ravens account at Locked On Ravens. Thank you for making Locked On Ravens your first listen of the day, and thank you to everybody who's shown support for me, whether it was this week or this month or last month or whenever it is. I really do appreciate it. With all that being said, though, we'll dive into it here, starting off with the Baltimore injury report. The Ravens, they're already done with their injury reports, with the game being today. The final injury report was actually yesterday, and it was a practice estimation because it was a walkthrough. So I'll just, again, read it through. We'll talk about it. So Latavius Murray with his ankle did not practice. He is doubtful for this game. Same thing with Patrick McCarvey. He did not practice with his ankle, so he is also doubtful. Brandon Williams with a shoulder injury did not practice. Again, he is questionable. And then you have Nick Boyle with a knee injury. He was limited. He is also questionable. Sammy Watkins with a thigh injury. He was full, and he is questionable. Marquise Brown with a back injury. He is full. He's not even listed. Same thing with Tavon Young. He's not listed. He had a knee injury. He was also a full participant in this game. So this is about what I was expecting. I didn't expect McCarvey to play in this game. It seems very doubtful he's going to. Same thing with Latavius Murray with his ankle injury. Brandon Williams is the only middling shock to me. I didn't really know a ton about his injury, but it seems like he might really not play in this one for the second straight week. And it's something where I thought maybe it was only like a week injury and he was going to be able to come back. But on a short week, it kind of does make sense that if Williams wasn't feeling well enough to play on Sunday against Minnesota, then the Ravens just like, all right, let's hold you out. We're not going to let you play on the short week. And that's something that we're not going to do. So I understand that for sure. Other than that, though, it does seem like Baltimore is going to get back both Nick Boyle and Sammy Watkins, two really big pieces for different reasons. But still, this Ravens offense is starting to get healthy. And as we talked about with Kyle Crabbs yesterday on our crossover Wednesday, because we're not doing crossover Thursday today because of the game, I feel like we're now going to see what the Ravens are about on offense. And that's not like we haven't seen it so far this season, but I'm just saying that with guys coming back and with guys out, really, we haven't really gotten to see this Ravens team at full strength. I mean, look, we're not going to without J.K. Dobbins and without Gus Edwards and some of those other guys too. But with Boyle and Watkins, and even if you want to throw in Cleveland and some of these other guys who are going to return, it seems like they're going to return. I mean, we're going to start to see the personnel that Baltimore wants to use a little bit more because they have the talent at their disposal. And that's not saying that, oh, you know, Devin Duvernay and James Prochet and Eric Tomlinson and Josh Oliver aren't good talents. They are, and they've played well. But having guys like Watkins and Boyle back on the football field is just so, so important, and they're going to provide a really big boost in this game. And just looking also at what the Ravens players and coaches did say, because with the injury report, it's pretty straightforward. I mean, we're probably not going to see Latavius Murray, probably not going to see Patrick McCurry, and probably no Brandon Williams as well, although he might be more of a game time decision, but the rest should be good to go. So looking at what some of the players said this week, Rashad Bateman has been pretty impressed with himself and his performance so far through three games, and hopefully he'll continue to build on that through the rest of his rookie campaign and obviously the rest of his NFL career. And it's been really nice to see Bateman kind of get acclimated with this offense and perform at a high level. He's not putting up 100 yards a game or 10 receptions or anything, but he's playing a role very well. And 11 of his 12 catches have gone for first downs. And that is impressive. And I think he should be impressed with himself, because coming on that strong early for a rookie who didn't really have the back half of training camp, didn't have the preseason, didn't have the first five games of the regular season, that's tough, especially for somebody who hadn't really ever played in an NFL game. If you really want to say, oh, what's the closest thing to game experience Bateman had, it was that open stadium practice. And then other than that, it's been the practices. So I've been impressed with Bateman so far, and I'm sure that Bateman also, as he said, is very impressed with himself, which was really nice. Calais Campbell talking a bit about the Ravens and their pass rush and the turnovers a little bit, saying he expects them to get it going in the second half of the season. And I really hope it's true. The Ravens, as we've talked about here this week on the show, averaging under two sacks a game, right around 1.9. They have 15 through eight games right now. That's tied for 26th in the league. They're a high pressure team. They can get pressure on quarterbacks, but as we've seen in recent seasons, you know, this team is good at getting pressure, but not great at finishing the plays and getting the quarterback down on the ground, which is very, very important and something that I think the Ravens should be prioritizing, that and the turnovers. The Ravens haven't forced a ton of turnovers this season. And I think in a game against Miami, and we'll talk about this in the final segment when we get into the Ravens defense against the Miami offense, the Miami offensive line is so bad where, I mean, if you can't get pressure on whether it's Tua or whether it's Jacoby Brissett on Thursday night, who are you going to do it against? Because the Dolphins offensive line has been that bad. So I know I believe in Campbell. Calais Campbell's been playing an all-pro level this season. He's been playing great. Adafi Owe has shown his flashes, although he's kind of disappeared in recent weeks. Justin Houston is always that savvy veteran you have. And you have a couple of other guys too who can really make an impact in the front seven. So I think that the Ravens sack numbers will get better, but if they don't, we start after looking at the question of, is it a talent thing or is it a scheme thing? Because we see guys like Matthew Judon be very inconsistent in Baltimore, very good player, but we see him kind of dominating in New England right now. The scheme fit was not right for Yannick Ngakoue, right? I'll kind of give the Ravens a pass on that because, yes, they acquired him and they just didn't use him properly, but like it was so bad of a fit that it's not surprising to me to see him dominate in Las Vegas right now and kind of do what he's doing over there. So we'll see what ends up happening. It'll be really interesting to see. Lamar Jackson addressed a mic'd up clip of him. He was running the football, about four or five Vikings defenders converged on him, brought him down, and he's just in there laughing. He's in there laughing like a little kid, and it was a really nice, heartwarming thing to see. And, you know, I'm talking about heartwarming stuff when these huge guys are converging and collapsing Lamar Jackson. But he was asked about it, and he's like, oh, you know, I'm mic'd up. Like, oh, I forgot I was mic'd up. And it's just those kind of interactions, those kind of engagements that, how can you hate Lamar Jackson? How can you direct any negativity towards him? He's a dynamic player on the football field, and off the football field, he's 10 times better. I mean, he's one of the premier talents in the NFL, but it's about how he carries himself off the field. It's about the example he sets for kids, for communities, and just how he's able to kind of win everybody over. He should be winning everybody over. You know, he addresses everybody. We've heard the, you know, Miss Lisa stuff, and that's kind of taken flight and gotten a lot of popularity, but he's just somebody who is so likable, and I really can't see how anybody dislikes him unless he's doing it to your team on the football field. Then I can understand, I don't like this. But, you know, as a person, I don't understand how anybody can hate on Lamar Jackson. We'll head into our first break, though. When we get back, we'll be diving into the Ravens Week 10 matchup with the Miami Dolphins here on game day for the Ravens, so stay tuned for that, and we will be right back. But This episode of Locked On Ravens is brought to you by McDonald's, proudly serving communities since 1965. McDonald's has always been more than just a place to get tasty, affordable food. It's a place where friends and family can come to reconnect, a place where classmates can meet up for a study group knowing they'll have dependable Wi-Fi and on the supplies of French fries and McFlurries. Win or lose, it's a place where teammates, competitors, the home team, or the away team can come to recharge. It's the place you always look forward to stopping at on a long road trip to rest your legs and refuel. You can go into McDonald's after a Little League game or even after a big sporting event, so head over to your local McDonald's to refuel and reconnect. I'm loving it. Hey Ravens fans, this is Kevin Ostreicher with an incredible app everyone who buys gas needs to know about, and Get Upside. Just download the free Get Upside app in the App Store or Google Play right now and use promo code Touchdown and get a bonus 25 cents per gallon on your first fill up. That's up to 50 cents cash back. Don't pay full price of the pump anymore. Get cash back using Get Upside. Just download the app for free and use promo code Touchdown to get up to 50 cents a gallon cash back on your first tank. Some people who drive for a lot are making as much as $200 to $300 a month in cash back, and there's no catch. Cash back gets added right to your account. You can cash out anytime to your bank account, PayPal, or any gift card for Amazon and other brands. Just download the free Get Upside app and use promo code Touchdown to get up to 50 cents a gallon cash back on your first tank. That's code Touchdown. We return here, our second segment of this Locked On Ravens game day edition on Thursday. Kevin Ostreicher, your host, still here with you, and kind of a wacky week here on Locked On Ravens, as we would usually be doing a crossover Thursday right now for a game on Sunday, but since the Ravens play today on Thursday, we did the crossover yesterday with Kyle Krabs of Locked On Dolphins. If you haven't checked that out, I highly recommend it. And we're doing our full game preview here for the Ravens in that matchup with the Dolphins. The Ravens outscoring Miami over their last three matchups, 137-16. That's just, it's unbelievable. It's 40.3 points per game, right around 40.3 points per game. The Ravens have won 8 of the last 9 meetings against Miami. So talking about this Ravens offense against this Miami defense, I mean, looking at the pure stats, let's start with Baltimore and their offensive stats. And obviously there's a lot more that goes into it than the pure box score stats. And that's why I look at net yards and yards per attempt, because the overall total yards, for me at least, again, as I've said before on this show, it's a product of an offense depending on how much a team runs or how much a team throws. So Baltimore through 9 weeks are ranked 8th in net yards per pass attempt with 7.1, and they are ranked 3rd in yards per attempt on the ground at 5 yards per carry. Now, if you actually want the yard stats, the Ravens are number 1 in rushing yards with 1,293, and they're actually 8th in passing yards with 2,130. So this is an offense that is performing well on both aspects of the game, but really the rushing offense hasn't been what we've seen in recent season. And obviously, look, that's what it's going to be without J.K. Dobbins or Gus Edwards on the field. You have Latavius Murray and you have Devonta Freeman and Le'Veon Bell and even some Tyson Williams in there, but those just, they're not the same players that Dobbins and Edwards are. This isn't 2016 or 2017 anymore either. So those guys have also just lost a step. You know, it's just what it is. So I think in this game, it'll be important for Baltimore to establish a ground game. Now the Miami defense will look at the same things. They're allowing 6.7 net yards per attempt. That is 22nd in the NFL. So right in the like bottom half of the middle tier, kind of, you know, bottom-ish third of the NFL. And then the rushing defense, they're allowing 4.3 yards per carry, so 14th. So they're a middling rushing defense. So if the Ravens can continue their momentum and what they saw and what they were able to get out of the Minnesota game in terms of the rushing department, where it wasn't just Lamar Jackson. Jackson had a huge day on the ground, but it wasn't just him. We saw Devonta Freeman make some plays, Le'Veon Bell as well. Now with Latavius Murray probably out in this one, maybe it'll be those two again. Maybe we'll see a bit more of Tyson Williams. Maybe Nate McCrary gets called up from the practice squad. We don't really know right now. But I do think that Freeman has performed a lot better than he did in the first half of the year. I've really liked what I've seen from him in recent weeks. I feel like he, at the beginning of the year, was just getting adjusted. And as were all these running backs who were new to the team, that's not something that necessarily surprises me in any way, shape, or form. But to the Ravens, establishing that ground game, considering how well their passing offense has played this year, if they can force Miami to bite on some play action, if they can allow Miami to kind of get in their own heads a little bit and try to stop this Ravens offense in both facets, then you have a bit of an issue if you're Miami, because you can't necessarily sell out to stop the run, but you also can't drop everybody back and play the pass. It's kind of, it goes both ways. So when the Ravens or if the Ravens establish their run game, then Miami starts creeping guys up in the box and saying, look, we have to stop it. We have to sit out a little bit more. And then you can get them to bite on the play action. You can get Marquise Brown open or Mark Andrews or whoever open down the field. You take some deep shots. You win the football game. I think that's one of the key success stories, or what could be a key success story for the Ravens in this game. Now, we did talk a bit about Boyle and Watkins, Nick Boyle and Sammy Watkins in the first segment. Boyle's return is going to be huge, because what I think it does for this offense is it opens up not only the ground game, but also the pass game. I think people sometimes forget a little bit about how Nick Boyle has grown and kind of evolved as a player over the last couple of seasons, where coming out of Delaware was really known as a blocking tight end, didn't really have a ton of receiving chops to his game, was really that, all right, he's going to block, he's not going to do much else right now. Over the course of his NFL career, he's really grown that part of his game. And it's kind of like what Mark Andrews has done over the course of his career. Andrews was like the opposite of Nick Boyle, where he was a pass-catching guy, wasn't really a strong blocker or anything, but he has improved his blocking to where he is very competent and actually a very good blocker in the run game. He gets after it in the blocking game. So for Boyle, he has grown his receiving skills. So it's not like, all right, Nick Boyle's lined up over here, the Ravens are running to that side, and that's it. Because now Andrews can block on the other side. Now, with the pass offense, it's the same thing with Boyle, as I just talked about, where now that Boyle's in the field, the Ravens aren't running the football only. They can do it, and they will do it with him on the field because he's such a good blocker. But now he can leak out. He can catch some passes. He can hurdle. We love the Nick Boyle hurdles. I have been waiting for some Nick Boyle hurdles, and I'm excited to see them again. Maybe we'll get one or two against Miami, because we know how those Ravens tight ends love their hurdles. But he's going to be a big part and just someone who really could make the players around him play a bit better. Maybe the offensive line a little bit, like Lamar Jackson, makes everybody around him play a lot better. And then Watkins, I'm really interested to see how Watkins plays and where Watkins plays, how much Watkins plays in this game, because Rashad Bateman has been getting a decent amount of snaps to start his NFL career, because Watkins was out, right? As the Ravens end up getting Bateman back, they lose Watkins. So those two haven't played on the field together. The Ravens haven't had their full complement of receivers on the field so far this season. It seems like they'll be getting those guys back and just making sure that right now they can incorporate those guys. And I think they definitely can. And they have so much talent this season at wide receiver that it's going to be it's exciting, because what are you going to do with Devin Duvernay? What are you going to do with James Prochet? Tylan Wallace really hasn't gotten a ton of run on offense. He's been great on special teams, but really hasn't gotten to play a ton on offense so far this season. So we'll see. I'm excited for Watkins and Boyle to return, though. I also hope that the Ravens offensive line can step up to the plate here. We've seen a lot of inconsistencies this year, and I think for the Ravens to make a deep Super Bowl run, they're going to have a bit more consistency. And look, I do give them a bit of a pass, because they've just been going through so many combinations, so many injuries. This offensive line was expected to have Ronnie Stanley and expected to have Villanueva on the right side, and you know, expected to have Phillips at left guard, and it just hasn't played out that way. So they've been shuffling, and then they find somebody at right tackle in Patrick McCary, and then all of a sudden he gets injured. So they've been shuffling all season long, and so it's a bit of inconsistency with that, because you don't really get to get comfortable with playing next to somebody, and all of a sudden you're playing next to somebody else each week, and it just becomes, all right, what are their tendencies? What are this guy's tendencies? So I understand that, but There are some quarters where the line looks great, and then other quarters where it's like they're getting bullied back into Lamar Jackson. It's been, you know, Villanueva has been very inconsistent this season. I think Bradley Bozeman's played well. I think Kevin Zeitler's played very well. Ben Powers has also been a bit up and down. McCary was great when he was in there. Phillips also an up and down player, but has a bunch of talent. So this is a game that the Ravens, it's a game they should get on track in. And I think that not just goes for the offense or the defense, you know, those two units, but in a more general perspective, you're looking at the Ravens offensive line and the other units on the offense, right? The run game, can they continue their momentum? The offensive line, can they do their thing, right? They have a lot of opportunities in this game to gain a lot of confidence. Not that they don't have any right now. They definitely do. They have a lot of it. They're 6-2, by the way. But I just think that with this Miami team not being good this season, they're kind of in a downward spiral. They did beat the Texans last week, but it wasn't convincingly. So they have an opportunity to get a lot done, to gain their confidence and make sure that they win this game pretty handily on both sides of the football. We'll be talking about the other side of the football in the defense when we get back from our final break. So stay tuned for that, and we will be right back. We're back in better than ever. A new web interface for the start of basketball season, but and more props, odds, and lines than ever before. BetOnline remains your number one spot for all the basketball and football action this season. Head to our new updated desktop or mobile website to sign up today and receive your 50% welcome bonus on your first deposit. Just use our promo code LOCKEDON to receive your bonus. From basketball, football, baseball, postseason, NHL, boxing, and UFC, right to your favorite Vegas casino games. Don't wait to take advantage of all the amazing offers available for the 2021 season. Bet online is the fastest and easiest way to bet on all your favorite sports. Bet online, where the game starts. We return here. It's our final segment of this game day edition of Locked On Ravens. Kevin Ostreicher still here with you as the Ravens are set to take on the Miami Dolphins in Week 10 on Thursday Night Football tonight. So the game is coming up. I'm excited for it. And I'm excited to see what this Ravens defense can do. This Miami offense has just not been good this season. Looking at their stats to start this off, Miami is averaging 5.2 net yards per attempt. That is second worst in the NFL. They're also averaging 3.5 yards per carry. That is third worst in the NFL. So it's just, it has not been good this season for Miami. Tua Tagovailoa, he might not play in this game. We don't know at the time of this recording yet. If it's not him, it's going to be Jacoby Brissett. They have Miles Gaskin in the backfield, Mike Gesicki, Jalen Waddle. They have talent, but the offensive line is where I want to start here. The Dolphins, it's been a struggle for the Dolphins. On the offensive line, they're going through a bunch of players who just are not playing well. I think three of their players literally lead the league. They're tied for the league lead in pressures allowed right now. That's just unbelievable. I think each of them has 37 pressures, literally each. So the Ravens and their defensive line, their front seven, I think this is a game, this is the game where they have to break out. And I predicted my bold predictions on Ravens Wire for this game. I said the Ravens are going to have 5+ sacks. Hopefully I'm right. Some of those bold predictions I can get a little crazy with, but I do think that this is the game the Ravens all of a sudden turn on the Jets, get to the quarterback, and not just get to the quarterback, but bring the quarterback down. Especially because if the Ravens get off to a fast start on offense, it will force Miami, I believe, to go a bit one-dimensional. They like to use Miles Gaskin on the backfield with passes, and they like to do a lot of stuff with Jalen Waddle and Gesicki, as I mentioned. But I think Justin Houston, Calais Campbell, Odafe Oweh, Tyus Bowser, Justin Madubuike, whoever you want to say, there'll be some good games in this one, I feel like. I hope. I really do hope. Because, again, as I talked about, if they can't do it against the Miami offensive line that it's just been atrocious this season, how are they going to do it? I think Don Martindale is going to be very aggressive. Maybe we'll see some corner blitzes, some safety blitzes. The Ravens are going to miss a big blitzing threat in Deshaun Elliott. He was really good off the edge and was able to generate pressure, get the quarterback down. But they still have Tavon Young, who's good at that. Maybe we'll see some from Brandon Stevens. They'll do a lot, I think, to just kind of set a tone. And I think that they can set a tone early and say, hey, look, we're coming at you with pressure. You're going to have to diagnose and figure out and call it the line and all that stuff. That'll be really good for them. And if it's Tua, I think something to keep in mind is that the Ravens defense for first-year quarterbacks, second-year quarterbacks, third-year quarterbacks who haven't seen the Ravens defense before, they usually don't perform well. Sometimes they do, but usually they don't. It's very, very challenging for, I think, a young quarterback to really grasp what this Ravens defense is doing because it is so complex, it's so complicated. And overall, like an example of this is Justin Herbert in Week 6 really struggled against the Baltimore defense. But then you look at Week 7 in Joe Burrow, that was his second time facing Baltimore. He had the tape, he saw what he did wrong, and he adjusted really well. But Tua's never played this Ravens defense. So if it is Tua, I think that he could have some trouble. If it's Jacoby Brissett, I also think he will have some trouble. Jacoby Brissett has not been great this season, much like Tua has not been amazing this year either. So either way, I have confidence in this Ravens defense. Josh Bynes has played really well. Patrick Queen's playing a lot better. Chuck Clark is Chuck Clark. He's been so good the entire season. Hopefully he's able to continue that even with his running without his running mate in Deshaun Elliott. But yeah, this should be a momentum-setting game. And I know the Ravens and their passing defense is not being good. They are giving up 7.3 net yards per attempt. That is 29th in the entire NFL. So not great there. The rushing offense is a bit better. They're giving up 4.3 yards per carry, which ranks 17th. So kind of a middling run defense that they have. But I don't know. I think the run defense has actually been a little bit better than the stats indicate, especially when you have like a Dalvin Cook 66-yard run, and then he doesn't really do anything the rest of the game. So those long runs can really skew stats and skew overall stats. I think that's why net yards per attempt is a bit better for passing and yards per attempt is a bit better for rushing to really gauge what an offense and defense can do. So, you know, the Ravens, after giving up that long run in against Minnesota, they really clamped down and didn't really let the rushing offense from Minnesota do a lot. And I think with Miami, who just has not run the football well this season, I mean, they haven't passed it well either. They haven't really played offense well this season. I just think that the Ravens have too much talent on defense to continue struggling in the secondary. Anthony Edwards played very well this season overall. Marlon Humphrey's still Marlon Humphrey. You have Tavon Young as one of the better slot corners in the NFL. It's just talent. Calais Campbell, Justin Houston. I mean, it's all these guys I've listed out already. But again, this is a game where they can use that confidence that they hopefully can gain from it in future weeks. But I do want to say this is a game that the Ravens cannot get complacent in. They cannot come into it saying, oh, Miami's 2-7. They can't run the football. They can't throw the football. They can't do anything. We're going to win this game easily. You cannot underestimate any opponent at the NFL level. I think a lot of people think the Ravens did that with Cincinnati. I don't think they necessarily did that, but it just shows that any given week, any team can beat you. And that has to do with mental preparation. I think John Harbaugh is very good at getting his team prepared, but it's about execution on the football field. And if the players are thinking, yeah, you know what? It's all right. We gave up a big play, but we're going to get them back because they can't do anything well. And then it just keeps happening and happening and happening. So the Ravens need to get under that mindset that, look, we're going to come out and dominate this team because they can beat us and they're a threat. Every team the Ravens play is a threat, regardless of if they're 9-0, if they're 0-6, if they're 2-13, whatever you want to say, regardless of how well or how not well a team has played this season, the Ravens, they have to come out ready to win the football game. I think they will do that. And this is a team that's just, I mean, we've talked about it so many times. It's a resilient football team. They're a team that's able to go out there despite the injuries, despite having to go through so many combinations of players and multiple different areas of their team, go out there and win close games, come from behind victories. Lamar Jackson continues to grow, to squash narratives, the rushing offense getting on track, the wide receivers playing well. You know, the offensive line, a bit of inconsistency, but they've shown flashes. The defense also shown flashes, definitely not what we expect out of a Ravens defense. But again, hopefully this is the game the Ravens can figure it all out and go out there and play a really dominant game. So for my final score prediction, I've gone back and forth. I'm going to give it Baltimore 34, Miami 16, with maybe the box score looking a bit closer than the game actually is, like a late touchdown or a late field goal. I don't expect this one to be close. If it is, I'd be very shocked. And if it is, I'll own up to it. But I just don't see how the Ravens don't dominate this team, a team they have dominated over recent years for a very long time. I just can't see how this Ravens team ends up losing to a Miami team that has struggled, doesn't really have a ton of momentum outside of actually winning the game against Houston, but it wasn't a pretty win. Whereas for Baltimore, they came from behind, they won the football game, they have that momentum, so I'd like to see them use that momentum and really perform well against the struggling Miami Dolphins football team. So I'm going 34-16 Ravens. We'll see how it all plays out. I'm excited for tonight's game. And of course, we'll be covering it all here on Locked On Ravens. That's all I have for you today, though. When we get back tomorrow, we'll be diving into everything that happened in the Thursday night matchup between the Ravens and the Dolphins. So stay tuned for that, and I will see you tomorrow.